Hey everybody, Reid Duke here. Welcome to a gameplay video here on ChannelFireball.com. Today I'm playing a four-round modern preliminary event, and the deck that I've picked is JUND, but specifically JUND Urza's Saga. So you may have been seeing me play a lot of JUND on the YouTube channel, especially in the last month or two, and I've sort of been splitting my time between classic non-Saga JUND, and then this version that you see in front of me, sort of honing my deck list, my sideboard, deciding which artifacts are necessary to have in the main deck versus which ones can be relegated to the sideboard, all things like that. But I have been liking this deck, which is the most important thing, which is why I've continued playing it and making videos with it. And I hope that I can show off some of its power today. Before we get to that, I do want to let you know about the CFB Pro subscription service. So that gives you access to all of the written content from me and my teammates, deep dives, deck guides, sideboard guides, evergreen stuff. The day you subscribe, you get access to a huge library of content, years in the making. It's only $7 a month. And on top of that, you get all the benefits from the TCG player subscription. So I do encourage you to have a look at that subscription offering. I also want to say thanks to Ultimate Guard. I have this unopened, beautiful treasure hive to show off. Look at that color. I'll even switch the view for a second. Yeah, get a look at that. Winter edition treasure hive. I really like the sort of sky blue winter color. So I'm excited that they were kind enough to send me this. But yeah, thanks to Ultimate Guard. And yeah, we've got a great four matches lined up for you today. I've been enjoying playing these preliminary events. They're pre-scheduled events on Magic Online. They're four rounds, so they usually only take 3 hours, a little under 3 hours sometimes if they go fast. And you can get qualifier points, which gets you into Magic Online Championship Series events, super qualifiers, whatever it might be. If you have a Magic Online account, you should take a look at the preliminary and weekend tournament schedule. So one of the first things that I did when I picked up this deck, I did reference a successful list, but I kept adding more copies of Mishra's Bauble. I think it just makes sense to play Bauble. It's good with Delirium, good with Tarmogoyf, pumps up your constructs. And it's basically a low-cost thing that you can have in your deck to ensure you always have something to search for on Chapter 3 with Urza's Saga. After sideboarding, you bring in the best targets in any given matchup, but you always want to have a couple of Mishra's Baubles as backup. Sometimes you play these super long games where you're recurring Urza's Saga with Renin 6, and you don't want to run out of stuff. Okay, let's get to it. Next level, Chapin. Gonna mulligan the one lander on the play. Ooh, so now a six card one lander on the play with a fetch land and a Renin 6, which means if I hit my second land, I'm in great shape, basically. And I have 2 1 mana plays. You know what? I'm gonna keep this rather than go to 6 cards. But another tricky thing is, what land am I going to fetch for? Probably Overgrown Tomb. So bottom the Terminate, Overgrown Tomb, Inquisition. Think it's better than going to 5. At least with this hand, I have a great hand if I draw a land. And even if my second draw step is a land, I think I would take this over going to 5. You can win with 5 cards, but it's a pretty big disadvantage. I think this is a definite mulligan if it's a 7 card hand. And it's probably a close keep with 6 cards, but I wouldn't fault you for throwing this back. Generally speaking, you do want to mulligan your one landers, especially on the play. But here goes nothing. Ah, okay. Wouldn't be a Reid Duke JUND video if I didn't face Tron at least once. Oh, and it's just a thought sees proof turn three Karn. Would you look at that? Yeah, I got nothing here. I might as well just right click the concede button after seeing this hand. Take Chromatic Star, I guess. At least I can feel satisfied that if I made a bad keep, it wouldn't have mattered anyway. I was not beating this hand on five cards before sideboarding. So now I draw Thoughtseize, and my opponent never draws another relevant card for the duration of the game. Blast Zone, second Karn. You might ask why I'm continuing to play. I'm just a glutton for punishment. So if they have the Sanctum of Ugin, then I think I'm locked out. Yeah. So they could Karn something, play a new Karn, trigger the Sanctum of Ugin. Okay, so they're just intending to blast zone for two then. Is just the classic Tron experience of continuing to play for a bunch of turns in a row despite being like probably under 1% to win. Okay, so Ulamog in hand. I need to draw Thoughtseize and then Assassin's Trophy. All right, that'll do it. I am finally beaten into submission. Ancient Grudge, Alpine Moon, Stone Brain, Haywire Mites. Not a great sideboard. I don't have any dedicated land destruction. And Fatal Push, of course, is awful. Unholy Heat and Terminate are among my weakest cards. So basically, like, am I keeping a Terminate to hit a Wyrmcoil Engine, or am I keeping an Unholy Heat to deal 2 damage to a Planeswalker? I think I should probably keep Terminate. Sometimes they have some weird sideboard stuff as well. Boy, I don't even have Liliana. This is really not a good matchup. Well, I do get to, in theory, Stone Brain them before they have Tron. So maybe this game, I have a reasonable plan. All right, so they have Mine and Tower, so I just Stone Brain versus Power Plant. Urza's Power Plant, they have Mine Towers, triple check. Okay, Forest, Ancient Stirrings, Walking Ballista, Oblivion Stone, All is Dust. So they have some weapons. I mean, they don't have to concede this game. And then anything interesting about their deck list? They boarded in two Thrag Tusks, two Walking Ballistas, two Worm Coils. They have four Karn the Great Creator, one Relic. All right. And then I'm just deciding what land do I want to play. Do I want to start making constructs next turn? Or do I want to get Ren and Six going? I think I just want to get Urza's Saga going. I accidentally crossed out an All is Dust, but they have a known All is Dust in hand. Yep. So I could destroy that Oblivion Stone with Kolaghan's Command or even Haywire Might, which seems like probably a better option. All right, let's take the draw. And I'm just going to leave this bauble uncracked because I would way rather increase my clock compared to just drawing a random card that I might not even be worthwhile to cast. Blast Zone doesn't work for zero. I can, in theory, present lethal next turn with, you know, Kolaghan's Command, some combination of damage, bringing back the Haywire Might, making a construct to pump the existing constructs, but they're likely to play a 3-3 Ballista here. Thrag Tusk. Okay. Yeah. Sure. So now I guess I'll go, you discard, I pick up Haywire Mite. It's not super clear whether making them discard or dealing two damage is going to be stronger. Ooh, Nature's Claim on the Saga. That is pretty good. They discarded Ulamog, so they have Walking Ballista, All is Dust, and then one unknown card. Feels like I should take the Ballista, because at this point the All is Dust is kind of hurting them more than it's hurting me. Choosing to not trade against the Thragtusk. If they attack Ren with the Thragtusk, I could just take it and then attack back for 11. It's like the Ren and Six is probably eventually going to die to either the All is Dust or the Blast Zone anyway, so it's not that big of a deal. Okay, I think I'm just passing here. Just the plan is overwhelm them with Urza's Saga. I actually believe I have a better late game now, or at least, you know, from this board position, I have a better late game. Another Ballista? Ugin. Okay. Yep. I think I have lethal here because Constructs are going to be 6-6, so two of them get through. That's 12 damage, plus two from the Ragavan, plus one from the Wren. And that's it's all thanks to that Mishra's Bauble still being in the deck. I got one, at least, exceeding my expectations. Okay, so now I've seen Thragtusk, Walking Ballista. I think it makes sense to have the Terminates as my flexible slots. Slaughter Pact could be okay. One Terminate, one Slaughter Pact. All right. This is the tough one where I'm on the draw. I basically need them to not have what they had in game one. I think I'm going to mulligan. Like, you could make a case for, okay, I get to see three new cards before my second turn, but the problem is this is just, it's a fine hand, but it's not like, it doesn't have sideboard cards, you know? So maybe if I had something as strong as Alpine Moon or Stone Brain in my hand, then I would justify keeping the land light hand, but this hand is like, there's the fail case where I'm going to auto lose if I don't hit my land, and I could just lose a normal game even if I hit my land. So I think I'm going to grudgingly mulligan. I mean, this is... this is... boy, this is a good hand if I hit a colored land on the first turn. And similarly, I get to see three cards before my second turn. But the problem is, like, this Urza Saga is kind of just nothing. So do I want to gamble it all on hitting my first land drop? On having a land on top of my library? Or do I go to five? It's kind of, like, similar to the game one situation. I'm going to mulligan. Sure. So land, Wren, Ancient Grudge. I guess Proving Ground. Opponent kept six, by the way. Karn the Great Creator. Um, Well, they're not going to have turn three Tron. That's something at least. I have to get the stone brain out before I have to play it and use it before the Karn hits the battlefield, so that kind of locks my decision. Okay, so I have to name Urza's Tower. I have to let them have their Karn. This is going to be a lot harder than the previous game was. I'm going to stop them from getting Tron, but this time they're going to have their land drops. They're going to have action. They're going to be on the front foot. So it's going to be much harder for me. Urza's Tower. Yeah, that's a really good hand they have there. The Ancient Grudge can allow me to fight a little bit. Oh, but you know what? They still have to hit a fourth land. They have three draws to do it, but they do have to hit. Just having a look if there's any surprises in the deck. Full four Nature's Claims. And then they draw two cards to replace the towers that I took away. Ooh, they didn't hit the fourth land. This gives me kind of one extra turn of breathing room. So yeah, it looks like Inquisition into Fable. Hopefully the game doesn't go long enough for that Ulamog to enter the equation. There's the Karn. Oblivion Stone, sure. That sounds like a prime Ancient Grudge target. I'm going to discard the Bauble only. I think Ren and Six and Grudge are just good on this board. Tireless Tracker. Oh, baby. All right. This is going to be attack Karn, play Ren, ping Karn, sack the treasure, play Tireless Tracker. Has to be done in that order because Karn has to die before I can use the treasure. And it does stink if the tracker gets killed, but there's just no reason to believe that that's going to happen based on what I know of my opponent's hand. I think they're almost certainly going to play Oblivion Stone or maybe Wyrmcoil Engine. And then I'm just going to grudge the Oblivion Stone before they have the mana to use it. Gonna use these in my upkeep. Okay, I'm going to pass and then terminate the Wyrmcoil when they attack. Because I could attack now and terminate the Wyrmcoil when they block, but then they have attackers to threaten my Planeswalker. So this is better to just get on the right track in terms of a full turn cycle without worrying about the Wyrmcoil engine. We're actually getting into the realm where they could play Oblivion Stone and use it in the same turn, which would definitely be annoying. One Ulamog and one unknown card in hand. I think I'm going to skip playing the Goyf because I feel like I'm only really losing if my opponent manages a board sweeper like a Ugin or another Oblivion Stone. I'm just going to pass with the intent to crack some clues. Yep. So that is pretty much exactly what I was worried about. Thank you. Well, suddenly this game is a lot closer than I thought. I am grateful that I got a big influx of card advantage from the tireless tracker because I'm going to need that. But I went from like being pretty sure I was going to win to now the game being too close for comfort. I can blast zone the Goyf. I didn't play the Goyf because they have the blast zone anyway. Brutal. Also, my clock's running down, so I gotta make moves here. It's my last fetchable land. At least that's an answer to the Karn. Two lands away from Ulamog. Three lands if I make them use the blast zone. All right, no Ugins off the top, please. See if they take the 10. All right, they took 10. Second main phase, crack this clue. I should have cracked the clue with the Fable trigger on the stack. That was actually a significant error. That happened because I'm trying to play fast. So now I'm going to trophy the blast zone. They can either use it, at which point they're still not on track for the Ulamog. Why didn't they main phase expedition map? I don't get that. Because don't they want to put a ninth land on the battlefield for the Ulamog? So now I think they're dead unless they top deck. They need Wyrmcoil, Karn, Thrag Tusk, Ulamog, Oblivion Stone. No, they drew Forest. All right, I beat Tron. That's a good start to a Jund video. I'll be back for round two. Okay, I'm back. Once again, fortunate enough to get to go first. Sure. So I'm gonna start with Bauble, the opponent, get a little more information about what could be what they're gonna be working with, and then Inquisition. My opponent has mulliganed. Ottawa Soaring City. Guess I'll take Ragavan. Just because there's too much to lose if I don't hit a green source or somehow my draw becomes awkward. Oh man, this kills me. Having Unholy Heat and being unable to kill the turn two Ledger Shredder. I think Ledger Shredder being printed really improved the stock of Lightning Bolt and Fatal Push as compared to Unholy Heat. Oh, they're not going to go for it. So am I putting them on a counterspell if I play the Fable? If so, then I can just make a construct. I guess I'll do that. And then I will have Delirium next turn. I'll be adding land enchantment. Well, they're playing pretty cagey here. Sure, I'll just make a token. So I was trying to think if it's meaningfully different to, you know, which saga I wind up tapping. Couldn't really figure out a good reason to do one way or the other. So they did have counterspell. So now there's three spells in the graveyard. Basically, what I want to avoid is facing down a 7-7 Murktide Regent. But as long as it's only going to be 6-6 and I can kill it with Unholy Heat, then I'm fine. So they have one Ottawara and one Unknown card in hand. Right. Okay, I'm going to make a construct. I'm gonna bobble them because if they show Murktide Regent, then I'll know that I have to crack the spell bomb. I think I like they have auto aura, so I'm not just gonna kill them like uncontested with the two constructs. Yeah, I think I wanna hit lands. Okay, so just one Ottawara in hand. They're not attacking with the Ledger Shredder. I wonder why. I'm going to go with Fatal Push. Spell Bomb you and draw a card. Still no green mana in all of this. They have Ottawara, so that if I attack with both, they could go block one Ottawara, the other kill both. So I'm going to be patient, which I have that luxury to be patient because their draw is really bad. Just kind of having to fade Expressive Iteration into multiple good cards. Yep. Oh no. All right, they were entitled to at least one decent draw step because they had been drawing very poorly up till now. So I basically know they have something good in hand. Discard Goyf Goyf. Wow, still no lands? Unreal. Unreal. Yeah, okay. So now I'm going to upkeep Unholy Heat this so as to not trigger the Connive. I'm out of searchable cards, searchable artifacts. Fair enough. This is like I just haven't had a green source in my top 22 cards. That's pretty wild. Yep. Still no green mana. 25 cards deep. But now they're dead because this has to attack, and then I just have two lethal attackers. All right, so Blood Moon is definitely scary. On the draw, I'm guessing I want like effectively every card that kills a creature. Ragavan on the draw is not super exciting. All right. Just have to play really carefully around Blood Moon, I think. Could see boarding out like the fourth copy of Urza's Saga. Maybe I like that. Because they're going to have Blood Moon and Dress Down. Engineered Explosives. So having one of those multiple Urza's Saga draws can lead to a lot of bad things. So remember, you can't fetch turn one basic swamp and still play Renin 6. Okay, they bobbled themselves, then decided to fetch. I'm going to bobble myself because if it happens to be a one mana removal spell, then I have some options. A lot of scary stuff. Do you think we would be okay to come? I mean, I think that's Think I'm going to take their ledger shredder. And then the thinking is they can play unlicensed hearse, which will mess with my Wren. But really what I want to do with the Wren is just minus one on the Ragavan. Slaughter Pact. Well, the cat's out of the bag. I'm not going to get to blow them out with that anymore. Wow, their turn for the crazy mana screw. They just expressive iterationed and didn't hit a land. Okay, so it's either Inquisition plus Fatal Push or just Wren and minus. I'm going to go with Inquisition and Fatal Push because it is a little bit annoying if they get that unlicensed hearse onto the battlefield. Maybe that's wrong. Okay, I changed my mind. I'm going to just play Wren and minus. Just get the guaranteed value. Seasoned Pyromancer, Unholy Heat, Subtlety. Definitely going to take the Pyromancer. So now I'm going to plus and target my Bloodstained Mire. They're going to use the hearse, and I'm going to respond. No, okay, I'm wrong about this. I was not really thinking straight. I'm going to eat the Expressive and the Scalding Tarn so that that way they don't have Delirium. All right. Well, nobody's allowed to have any graveyards. The most ineffective of graveyard hate cards. So remember, Subtlety, Unholy Heat, one unknown card. Subtlety hits creature or planeswalker spell, so I could cast Fable. And I will. Should I crew and attack? Nah. Because if I was to crew and attack, they could flash in Subtlety, crew, block, tap their hearse to pump, and then I have to choose like one or the other of their creatures to kill. I'd rather just not get behind in that way. Okay. Kind of thought they might have had Ledger Shredder from an earlier turn where they tapped two islands and then thought better of it. Did I use this last turn? I think I forgot to plus the Ren last turn, which is a bummer. Probably not going to be the determining factor in the game, but you should definitely use your planeswalkers. Okay, I think I'm gonna not discard anything. I kind of like what I'm working with. I knew this Ren would be good for something. Double teaming the Ledger Shredder. Sure. Why do they must have clicked through exiling this? I'm not sure. What if they have dressed down? Dressed down would kill my unlicensed hearse, right? All right, I'm just gonna pass. It's kind of a little bit of a rough game, hard to get any traction here. Yes. Wow, they actually did it. They found dress down. Yep. That's brutal. Blood Moon. I almost have a Ren emblem, but it's actually not doing much. I'll pull for the Gigantha, which I didn't do this on any previous turn because I didn't want to put the shields down on having Fatal Push, because, like, even well, we're in the realm where one hit from these unlicensed hurts kills me, so I want to leave up removal at all times. Consider. Consider. All right, upkeep. I'm going to eat these two considers. I'm going to Kolaghan's command to destroy one of these hearses and make you discard. Ottawara, my unlicensed hearse. All right. Seiju their hearse. Both games I'm out of targets, but these have been like unusually tough, scrappy games. Might be the first time I've had a Ren in six on nine counters. Kind of comical. Yep. How close are we to lethal here? So make a construct, unholy heat the Murktide, ping the Murktide, crew this. They're at an effective one life. They're looking for dress down, I guess. Still going. But they are dead to the wrens, even if they find dress down. Yikes, that was quite a game. See you for round three. Hey, I'm back once again with Jund Saga, once again on the play. And this hand is acceptable. I'll stop short of saying exciting because it is a five lander, but I have a great one mana play, a great two mana play, and then Urza Saga gives me more action. I'm actually going to play Black Cleave Cliffs untapped just so that if my opponent is playing a creature deck, I can curve out. Yep. Ooh, very nice curve out, though. It's the unfortunate Tarmogoyf with no land in the graveyard, so it can actually be lightning bolted. Yep, there it is. All right. Big bucks, no spell pierce. Hooray. So both players doing just exactly what their decks want to be doing. All right, I think I'm going to discard just Overgrown Tomb because I want to have plenty of mana. Well, let me think about this. How am I losing this game? I'm probably losing to a big Murktide Regent, so I should therefore probably dig as deep as I can for an answer. But my thinking is that I would love to play a land this turn, make a Construct, and play Ragavan, and then still have Urza Saga to play the following turn. But I'm going to discard the two non-Saga lands. And at worst, I can just play the Saga this turn to have enough mana. Okay, sticking with the plan. I don't want to get hit by that Ragavan, so I would love to present two creatures that can block it. Yes. And there it is. So this is going to be a 7-7. Well, let's find colored mana, please. Wow, that is terrifying. I mean, it's hard to leave them with a counterspell to protect the 7-7 Murktide. But if I leave them with the Expressive Iteration, they get to see four cards, and then they could just find a counterspell, and it's even worse for me. Is there any way I can race? Like, if I leave them with the counterspell, they attack me to 13. So I leave them with the counterspell, make a 2-2 construct. They attack me to 13. Then I make another construct, get a bauble, copy a construct. I'm attacking for 10. So if I leave them with the counterspell and they brick twice, I can just win with constructs. I think that's a better plan than hoping they brick on the Expressive Iteration, because that just never, ever happens. But boy, those are not the two cards I was hoping to see when I Inquisitioned. Ledger Shredder, it's hopefully not that bad. So I can make a construct and attack for 10. If they block, then they're at 11. I'm still kind of presenting lethal for next turn. Or I can attack for 4. Hope they brick, and then end of turn make a construct. Untap, make a construct. Then they'll be 6/6s. I think it's better to make a construct now, because in the world where they do have to leave back the Murktide Regent, I want to have unloaded as much damage as possible. All right. So if they brick, if they just draw a land, they're going to have to leave back the Murktide Regent. Right. Well, hopefully if they find something, it will at least mean they have to tap their mana. Okay, so they found Ledger Shredder. So now Shields are down on Counterspell and Riveteer's Charm is unlocked. Okay, seems to me like I should not crack either... I should not crack the bauble.
Take care of yourself. You can bring a washcloth if you feel like you're in the
This is a tight one. All right, hard fought. Do roughly the same sideboarding as last time. Cut the fourth saga. Kind of a weird dynamic where I don't think Kolaghan's command is particularly good in this matchup in game one, but you need to have it to hedge against people bringing in unlicensed hearse against you. I don't think you can really bring in Ancient Grudge in a matchup like this, but you want to have something that's good if they have unlicensed hearse, but not dead otherwise, and I think Kolaghan's command is just the answer. So I'm kind of on don't leave home without two Kolaghan's commands these days, because of course it's amazing against the Urza Saga players, but also just anyone that has unlicensed terse or even might have unlicensed terse, you're really happy to have it. Okay, so classic dilemma of if you main phase kill the Ragavan, they can dash a second one. But in this matchup, I just think that's not as bad as having your removal spell counterspelled. So I prefer to main phase kill the Ragavan. All right. I think I like playing Ren. I'm going to do it off a basic forest, just a little tiny hedge against Blood Moon. And I didn't play the Bauble because I didn't want to trigger my opponent's Ledger Shredder for free. If they connive any non-land card, then they can attack and kill the Ren. But if they connive an instant or like an artifact or enchantment, then they have Delirium. All right, so they've done it. Nice turn. Ugh, and the Lightning Bolt. One turn too late. So I think I'm gonna start going to work with the hearse. Because I don't want my opponent to play Murktide Regent. I feel like I'm in some trouble. Well, I'm just gonna have to trigger the Ledger Shredder from my opponent. Target myself. Top card is a fatal push. That's definitely good enough for me to draw. Target you. Another Ledger Shredder. So I'll play one Goyf. I'll draw into the Fatal Push. I'll have the Lightning Bolt in case I need it on the Ragavan or the other Ledger Shredder. Guess end of combat step. I'm gonna exile. It shouldn't even matter if I pump the Murktide more because I just have to answer it or I'm dead. So I exile the Bolt and the Shredder. Yep. So unfortunately, this is also going to trigger the Shredder. So I think I just lose at this point, but I'm going to do this rather than concede. Yep. GG. All right, game three. I get to be on the play. What do I want to do about these Ragavans? Think they're good. I think they're good when I'm on the play. So I can cut maybe like Unholy Heat, Goyf, Fable, Something like that. Or maybe three Ragavan, three Goyf, two Fable. Cut one of each. Very scientific, I know. Nope, can't keep this. Sure. Yeah. Okay, both players have six. This time, because I have two answers, I am going to let the Ragavan attack. This is what I wanted to happen. So it's actually pretty scary that they could just consider into Murktide right now. Although it would only be a 5-5. Okay, so they considered and put both cards in the graveyard, including an enchantment, so big old Tarmogoyf. So, do I want to exile the Pyromancer or a spell? I think I'll exile a Consider. So now if they're to play the Murktide, it's still a 5-5. Which is possibly beatable. It's not great for me. It's not great for me if they play the Murktide. But I think this is a low enough resource game that I can't really just like fire off the Soul Guide Lantern without knowing. Also, it would pump down the Goyf. So yeah, it's not a play that I can make. Drawing a card here makes it a 6-7 Goyf. Yeah. Should I? They can't respond with Unholy Heat because the Soul Guide hits the graveyard instantly. I think I'm going to do it. Yeah, see, 6-7 already, no opportunity to respond. If you want to double burn it, so be it. Yeah. Okay. All right, no Expressive Iteration, no Murktide. Those are the cards we don't want to see here. Seasoned Pyromancer is still relevant for what that's worth. This is probably getting counterspelled, but so be it. So they can go to 3 and exile the Seasoned Pyro. Oh, they have a Murktide coming up. I have Terminate at least. They can pump down the Goyf, but they can't really pump down the Goyf enough. So now let me think, is it correct for me to draw a card? Like, it is good to take the draw step if I'm going to find Inquisition or Thoughtseize. But if I draw, like, another card that I want to spend mana on, it can be bad. But I am going to take my draw step first. It worked. All right, friends, they're making me work for it, but I am 3-0. I'll see you for the fourth and final match. All right, friends, I'm 3-0 with Modern Jund Saga. That means this one is for all the marbles. I think I got to go first all 4 rounds, which that definitely influences your win rate in a format like Modern. Kahira the Orphan Guard, so either blue-white control or elementals. My hand is perfect. It's actually a little bit... No, I mean, it's just perfect. The Lightning Bolt and the Riveteer's Charm won't be that amazing if it is blue-white control, but look, I mean, Blood Crypt, Forest, Saga, Thoughtseize, Ren, that's perfect 5 cards. That looks like a blue-white control deck with, I guess, just blue-white control with leyline bindings. Okay, let's think about this. So the Teferi, generally strong card. Teferi and Dress Down are both pretty good against Urza's Saga. Memory Deluge is the most powerful card advantage card. Okay, so I'm going to play turn two Ren, turn three Saga, and get Gigantha. Then if they play Teferi, if they minus, that's fine. If they plus, then I can Riveteer's Charm it. Okay, I'm going to take the Memory Deluge. Just try to stick them with a low amount of resources. Could be wrong. The only card that I'm certainly not taking from that hand is Solitude, but I wouldn't fault you for any of the other ones that you might choose. Now, why would they play Misty Rainforest and not Zagoth Triome? Because they drew Leyline Binding? Is that what happened? So now they're going to get like Rogrin Triome and then Zagoth Triome and binding my Renin 6. So be it. Ugh, drawing the Fable now, I wish I had taken the Teferi, but hard to know at the time. Okay, so normally I would go Verdant Catacombs, pick it up with Ren. But if I believe that they're going to Leyline Binding my Ren in response to cracking a fetch land, do I want to play the Saga so that I have a play to make next turn? Doesn't even really matter because they have the Dress Down. All right, it's fine. Okay, I guess I was wrong about the. Leyline Binding. So now I expect them to play Teferi, bounce the token. Then I'll probably want to ping the Teferi with Ren and grab Gigantha. Or if they miss a land drop, they're in big trouble. What's this? Why not? Why are you not playing Teferi? Okay, here's the land drop. Declare my attack with the Goblin Shaman. What are you going to do about it? Sure. Solitude pitch to Fairy. Oh, I get it. So the Solitude is just on the battlefield permanently because of the dress down. Cool. That's a nice trick. Yep. Okay, so they pulled for the Kahira, so they have Kahira, Solitude, and one unknown card. Getting close to double bolt range. Especially if they like shock in another land. All right, Flooded Strand, Solitude, Kahira, one unknown card. They're probably just gonna hard cast a Solitude. Yep. Using my treasurer to terminate the Solitude. The Gigantha, let's see what you've got for me. Okay, I'm going to attack player. Bolt you. Riveteer's Charm is awkward against the Teferi. Goyf. Pass, I guess. Yep. All right, let's start with attack player. And they've got to have something. Nope. Right, one game away from the clean sweep. Not much in the way of sideboards. Haywire Might is good. Solgine Lantern, Stone Brain, Slaughter Pact. These cards are marginal, but definitely better than Fatal Push. Looks fine to me. Assassin's Trophy. Yeah, Assassin's Trophy can be good on Leyline Binding. Another good hand. All right, the monkey connects for damage. Archmage's Charm, not even close to being able to cast that. So now I could just play Goyf. I could cash in a treasure to play Thoughtseize. I'm just going to play Goyf. Zero, a mighty 0/1. Okay, this time I'm going to Thoughtseize because that will make the Goyf into a real threat, unload some damage. Okay, so I'm not going to take the Supreme Verdict. Think I'm going to take the Deluge. Although, if I take the Teferi, the Goyf is one bigger. So it's either going to be a 3/4 or a 4/5. Oh, is that meaningfully different? So, like, if I have a 4/5 Goyf, I attack and play another Ragavan. Then they take their next turn to Deluge. I Kolaghan's Command the Ragavan. It's probably good enough for me. Okay, I take Teferi. So now let's see, do they go for the Supreme Verdict? Or do they try to take a turn off? Binding the Ragavan. Then they attack and get the treasure so they can deluge in the same turn. Or they could just play Fable the Mirror Breaker. So the fact that they are chumping with the Goblin Shaman, it might be like they want to Supreme Verdict before Chapter 3 goes off with the Reflection. This is getting tricky. I'm going to go for Kolaghan's Command now. Okay, they discarded the Verdict. 5-6 Goyf. Okay. Memory Deluge and one fresh card. This looks like a Teferi, Hero of Dominaria, which is not good news for me. It's a Solitude, alright. Man, how do I not even have a fetch land in the graveyard? All right, Tarmogoyf, go. All right, thank you for the Urza Saga draw. So I definitely need to kill one of these two creatures. I can't leave them with both. Okay, you discard and I kill your Reflection. And then the Goyf's going to be at least a 6-7. If they hit a land, they can just deluge from the graveyard. It's not that bad. Oh, little help here. Not enough help. Not enough help. So the way I stay in the game is to ping the Hero of Dominaria, but then the Solitude kills off the Ren and Six, my opponent's life total is totally stabilized, and then they're either going to get A Kahira or a memory deluge. So this is getting bad. Okay, so the Haywire Mite is going to deal with the Chalice. Then I'm going to cast Soul Guide Lantern, which exiles the Deluge, which is a big key to staying in this game. And I'm going to draw a card. I'm going to play Ragavan. That was a decent turn, but the problem is, like, I need my opponent to have nothing, and I know that they don't have nothing because they would have played a land last turn if they had it. Slaughter Pact, okay. That's maybe something. Is this right? I mean, what do they have in their hand? Maybe I should just play Fable. Yeah, I changed my mind. I think I just want to play Fable. Okay, here's a Mistress Bauble. What's your top card? Your top card is Odawara. Here's a Fable. It resolved. That's good news. Block one, Slaughter Pact Kahira. So they can Odawara their own Kahira, but then the Slaughter Pact fizzles and I don't have to pay for it. Odawara on my Ragavan doesn't really do that much. Fine with this outcome. I'm fighting hard. So I need something to not be dead to the board. And it looks like I'm dead. All right, final match, final game. Wouldn't have it any other way. The only question is, like, do I want to bring in another Terminate? Is there anything in my deck that's not good? Like, cut the Nile Spell Bomb for a Terminate? I don't think so. Yeah, let's do it. I'm ready. Kind of interesting what to do with the bauble. I'm going to still bauble myself, because if I have a good card that I'm excited to draw, I don't even mind waiting on the Thoughtseize. So it's a Goyf. I guess that's fine. I mean, it is a threat. So turn two, play the Goyf, and then turn three, who knows what. I'll try to get some value from the Tireless Tracker later. I get a Blood Crypt, Goyf. You know, one thing that was really hard about the second game was my opponent having the threat of Supreme Verdict changed how I had to play my creatures, but then they never had to play the Supreme Verdict at all because I was sort of holding back. Okay, so here I have to decide if I want to crack the fetch land or save the fetch land for post Tireless Tracker, but then I might not be getting max value out of my Urza Saga. I guess I can definitely Thoughtseize first, and then that'll help me decide. I'm going to go with Verdant. Okay, so probably they just grab the Kahira, and then we'll see if they want to evoke Solitude. Okay, big turn. Have you found Supreme Verdict or something good? Teferi's good. Solitude, pitching solitude. Interesting. Make constructs. Replay Goyf. I guess make constructs. Plains, Scalding Tarn, and three unknown cards. Oh, sorry, one's Kahira. Yes, you have Kahira. Maybe I should have just bolted right away. Yeah, so I guess it's still just a 2 for 2. It's not the end of the world. So I'm doing okay resource-wise, but I don't like that I have no board presence. So like if my opponent finds Big Teferi or Memory Deluge or something, they can start really pulling ahead. Nightmare scenario, especially after I cracked the spell bomb. If this works, I'm going to name Memory Deluge, because I get to take away one of their relevant cards without giving them anything in their hand. Ooh, they actually had one in hand, but they do have Teferi, Hero of Dominaria in hand. All right, I would love to study everything that they have, but I don't really have enough time on my clock to do that. All right, so it's a couple of Teferis against the world, and usually I like the couple of Teferis in that battle. I just have three freshly drawn cards. Oh, shouldn't have tapped out of green mana. Just going after player here. Okay. Back to a little bit of a stalemate. I have the Urza's Saga. I have the Gigantha. A lot of their big Haymaker cards are now gone from the library. Okay, so they have Teferi and a couple unknowns. I'm ticking down on time, fighting hard. Still have Gigantha. Yep. Kill off the Time Raveler. Chalice 1, okay. Glaive attacks Time Raveler. So now, do I play the Fable or do I get Gigantha under the impression that they're going to have to bounce something next turn anyway? I don't want them to get a free kill on my token. Wow, they failed to find with the Windswept Teeth. We're really getting into it at this point. Draw two. Just trying to fade big Teferi. That's the card. That's the scary card here. They would have bounced for sure if they didn't have an answer to the Goyf. I still have some live draws here. I have all my Wrens. I have Kolaghan's Commands. So yeah, like if I find Kolaghan's Command, I can go kill your Chalice, bring back Haywire Might. Wren starts bringing back the Urza's Sagas. Ugh. Well, I guess the Fable, you know, I can discard two Inquisitions for redraws. Oh no! Come on, a little help off the top, please. No help, no help. Come on, Wren, Kolaghan's Command. Oh my god. Work against Chalice. If their Teferi is low enough in the library, I wonder if I can just deck them. How many Solitudes have they been through? Three, so they have one Solitude left too. Possible I specifically don't want to play any creatures. Thank you. 8 cards in library for the opponent, but I'm going to time out maybe before that's over. Wondering why my F6 button isn't working. There's the big Teferi. Hall of Storm Giants, that's pretty scary. Alright, here I take my shot with the Kolaghan's Command. Wow, it worked. I think I'm just going to kill the big Teferi and then just F6 for the rest of the game. Although I probably will lose to the Solitude in the Hall of the Storm Giants. Not going to be enough. I do have the Urza Saga to make blockers. They get 3 more turns of attacking, so in theory, if I could just block the hall, like 2 or 3 of those times, but I'm out of time. Man, I tried. What an epic game. I mean, I don't even know how to debrief after that one. So if we had had enough time, then I just have to hold out those last couple of turns. They're out of Teferis. They're out of Memory Deluges because of the Stone Brain. Just block the Hall of the Storm Giants a few times. I still have some more draws, like, you know, another Kolaghan's Command, whatever. More Wrens to keep bringing back Urza's Saga. And it's difficult for them to remove the Saga tokens at instant speed because the Teferi -3 doesn't work. So that game was, there was a lot going on, right? There was like the time factor, there was the decking, there was, you know, strategically like managing resources and stuff like that. But yeah, I mean, it was just epic. Like the way I really could have won was just manage my time a little bit better, which there were, it was like, first of all, when I'm recording, I'm talking through my plays, which slows me down by 5 or 10%. And then also there was something wrong. Like usually Magic Online has a button for me, it's F6. That should be auto pass until the end of the turn, but that wasn't working for me. So every turn I was eating up a couple seconds on my clock when it should have just been like automatic that I was done. But anyway, not that big a deal. At least we got a great match out of it, and kind of like an interesting one for learning how that plays out, especially with the Stone Brain taking away one of their big win conditions and the game going super long. But anyway, you can't ask for more fun matches than that. I thought all four were close and interesting. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I hope you'll join me again. See you next time.